Hello, everybody, and very welcome to this panel about consumer credit. It's an example that came up quite a few times yesterday, and I'm sure everybody is very curious about what our speakers have to say today. So we have three speakers. The first one is Dan Raviv from Lendbuzz. BuzzFeed is the next panel. We have Aaron Rieke from Upturn. And we have Frank Pasquale from University of Maryland. Dan, you want to start?
Yeah, sure.
Hello, everyone. Hey, thank you for having me. You know, this is the first time I actually give a lecture that the third slide is not a lot of equations. So actually, the first time. So for me, it's a new thing. And it immediately follows up the second part. So whenever actually, I've been many years in academia. I'll represent myself in a second. So for me, whenever someone came from industry, the first thing I was actually something between mad and pissed. Why doesn't he show us exactly what he's doing? Okay, so yes, we cannot do that. We cannot show you exactly what you're doing. Okay, the underwriting. As I move forward, you'll see what do I mean. But I have to admit that the debate afterwards, this is what actually I'm waiting for. Because there are many things that people ask that I would love to chat about it, especially even the same questions that were in the previous session. You'll see that why in a second. You need to understand, I'm the guy that will definitely prefer to go to 10 different AI models to hear if I have a problem. I'm not an idiot. If the computer will tell me to take off my hat because I have a headache, I will not do that. But I want 10 of those to tell me that. And definitely when it comes to consumer credits, if it ended up being with probability doing something, I'm the one to do that. I will take the AI system in the car. If there is a probability issue, it will deal less harm, okay? If there is a chance of less accidents. But we'll reach that point. Look, the story is the following, okay? It's very trivial. Let me present myself, okay? I'm coming from Israel, from the Technion. I have a bachelor in mathematics, a CS, and PhD in computer science. I was a member of the Technion Excellence Program. Those who never heard about the Technion is a very good university in Israel. Okay, very proud of that. I was in HP Labs for a while, then I moved to MIT. I was a postdoc over there for about 4 years, working in different problems in machine learning, computer vision, and fintech, a little bit later on along the road. When I came to the US, so I was the first affiliated to MIT, both me and my wife, both of us postdocs in MIT. And we have a fairly good salary, a pay stub, everything that we wanted to do. I went to the bank to get a loan for the car. They showed me the way out. Okay, there was not really an option to do that. This is, by the way, me and the love of my life. So I was actually rejected. I think they almost wanted to kick me in the ass as I moved out of the bank. Now, what is happening here is the US. Those of you who are Americans might not even know that. But the thing is that if you don't have a reasonable credit file, it's not just a FICO number, okay? It's not just a FICO number. If you don't have a reasonable file, you are non-existent to get federal credit. I could have gotten a loan, like in any other subprime, for something between 20 or 30%, and it just doesn't make sense. And the thing is, you know, is this the way to go, okay? I really like the phrase Silicon Valley is coming, okay? So we are not the only one who realized that there is a problem, okay? And we need to solve it. I will chat a little bit of what we are doing, how we are doing it, and for which population. But think for a second that the graphs on the bottom, I really like that one. It tells you basically the financial services is one of the industries really underserved online, okay? There is an issue. It's not just the underwriting. It's how everything is actually being treated in the system. Is the market, by the way, is large enough? It's huge. Just talking about students, for example, we're talking about like a million a year, roughly. I'm not even talking here about the expats coming here to the US. Those who are actually staying here, those who have the stems, actually keep on those in business and finance and so on. We're talking about, maybe it's not prime at first, but let's call it definitely near prime, a population that is treated as a subprime, definitely. And there is an issue over there. So what the hell happened? So Bill and Earl, who heard about Bill and Earl? Everybody here, right? Who heard about Bill and Earl? So that's the FICO, okay? So that's Bill Fair, right? And L. Isaac, the Fair and Isaac and Company, okay? Fair Isaac Company. And so they came up with the model that is running. Who knows when, by the way, did they come up with that? When did the company was founded?
1970s.
Yeah. Unfair, you cheated.
I wanted to tell people, don't check Wikipedia for that. So actually, I was shocked, because I thought it was like in the 70s, but we did it like 20 years before that, so it was around 56. And so when the model came out, it was great, really. And I have to admit, the model is good. It's doing well. For what? For specific sorts of demographics, specific for specific peoples. And this is roughly how it's built. You can find those, you know, those charts online. Everybody knows about that. And you ended up going actually to get a loan. They check your number. If it's a, it's going to be for car loan, they're probably going to give you one number, just one of those three major players, the bureaus. For mortgage, by the way, they're going to give you a, they need all three, by the way, they give you some, a report of everything. And to be fair, it's not just the FICO. So by the way, people come here after a month. They don't have a social, by the way. They can still have a credit file. They will not give you a number, but they can actually give you a file to actually, to see how it actually goes and collect it, but it's not good enough. So even if they end up getting a number, let's say 750, roughly 6 months after that, paying their bills, nobody will give them a loan yet, okay? So there is an issue. And the thing is that AI solves many of those problems. As long as you understand that there are dramatically more information you need to actually to look and examine in order to do that. So I just put a few things over there that we actually, for example, today we'll look at, okay? When you're actually looking at a person, I'm sure that some of you, when they read it, someone wants to raise his hand and shout, but FCRA, blah, blah, blah. So I'm not saying everything here, okay, is actually going to underwriting. Many of those things, for example, go for a, you know, for fraud detection and identity verification and many other problems that the data that is there tells us about it. So the thing is that if you're looking at educational background, employment history, financial status, financial behavior, there are many things that we know today about a consumer. There are many things the consumer is willing to let us know about him. When I came here, for example, I was fine for someone to open my bank accounts and see what is happening, to see that people, believe me in some sense, okay, it doesn't make sense. I have nothing to hide. Not everybody, by the way, is willing to do that. But those who are willing, so think about it as a conditional probability, we can tell a lot about them. And what we can tell, for example, what the company is doing, one is an alternative scoring. So this is, for example, what is known as the Lendbuzz score, so what we are actually replacing FICO with. We can talk about potential scores, meaning what do you think will happen to this person in the future. And of course comes the part, so this is the part, by the way, you think about the difference between, if you want, the accuracy and correctness. And the thing is that we also, for example, want to know what is the probability for this person to be default or late. So think about it for a second. I might be giving a person a perfect score in some sense, but he still is going to be late or defaulted, okay? The question is, what are the numbers are going to tell us as the numbers keep us increasing? I think maybe now it's also maybe it's the time to mention that. So Lendbuzz started as an alternative scoring. Last year, we also opened up a financial product. So we're actually giving loans. We are the bank, okay? I'm also the bad guy from the bank. We are also giving loans starting roughly about the last year. So chatting a little bit with some people before that, just for the record, so we are actually giving loans to people that nobody in some sense want to touch them, claiming they are subprime, and our file actually behaves like a prime or near prime, okay, according to that. So whether the model is accurate or correct, the answer is that for the last year, yes. Probably as you move along, it will be easier and easier to prove that this is what is happening. Because this is what, you know, we're still a startup. So this is what we hope that we'll actually keep on showing here. What I show you in the bottom is it's trivial, but it's something that is critical when you talk about consumer credit, especially when we talk, for example, with investors. So the fact that we have an alternative credit score, this is, let me tell you, like a secret, put it in parentheses, it's irrelevant, okay? In the sense that, yes, I have a score, okay? It's a number, but if I'm going to get 650 and your fit will get 650, we are definitely not the same, okay? I cannot get a person and just, you know, plug it into one number. FICO, it worked for a while, and you know something, it works considerably well in the sense everybody that has 700 will behave in, and then you have the curves, how it's going to be the default and late. But whether that's the way to go, I'm definitely not sure. So getting other numbers below that, like for example, potential, educational, and so on. So we do those things. This is like another layer below that. But what is really interesting in the end of the day is the vector representing the person, okay? So when you are profiling a person, it ended up being a vector. So unfortunately, I'm not a number, I'm not four numbers, I'm actually a vector representing me, which allows us to actually do those tricks along the way. I did hear that you have, actually I wasn't here yesterday, I'm sorry, but I heard that you had a session just specifically about technical issues with neural nets. I do want to tell you, to give you like my 3 cents about it. And this is why I also started this talk, telling you that I'm the guy who will go with the numbers. So many, for example, of the things that I hear here about people who like complain but the computer might be wrong, the net plots giving the, you know, so let's not move with that specific product. I don't personally think that the problem is with the, you know, with the system, meaning with the AI. The problem is how do you train the model and how you prepare for that, meaning that not all models for AI are exactly the same, okay? There are ways to train. If, for example, the example, Rich, a beautiful example that you get with the patients, that the system keep on changing every other year what is going on, but it basically means that the data is biased, okay? So how do you manage biased data? Then build an algorithm that will do that. Maybe you can find another problem, then you need to build it another model to actually handle that, right? What happens if the data is super biased? 99% of our clients are paying, one is not. Then what happens? And I'm not going to give a loan to anyone. No, the only thing is that we need to understand how to train those models, and now it becomes a little more difficult. I cannot throw it to a learner, some neural net that you learn that you can actually do that, and everybody is now an expert in learning. You need to understand that you need to talk to a different set of problems. It's more like abnormality detection. Well, how do you do that with biased set of data sets along the way? So I'm the one who thinks that there is a solution to those things. And if I put it in parentheses, and you're going to kill me after that, I know that, with all the questions, but if you know how to train your system, it will do better than you, okay? If you know how to train it. And the thing is that you do not always know that, okay? I do get it, okay? Which might be an issue. But if you do know how to train it, it will do better. And if it ends up being the numbers, okay, then I would prefer to get with the numbers with higher probability that it will work or not. So I want to show, for example, what happened in machine learning, because I don't know if you actually talked exactly about that, but All the machine learning things are here for so long, okay, really, it's been here for decades. What changed, I think, and happened that everybody now talks about machine learning is the appearance of deep neural network, and it's not exactly the appearance. By the way, who knows, except Rich, when was actually those models generated at the beginning of deep neural network? How long have they been here? I'm going to give you a peek, and then we go back to this slide, okay? Around early 30s, okay? This is the first time that actually something was actually written about neural nets. People, it's an oldie. Those of you who actually did algorithms, it was dramatically before support vector machine. But support vector machine was the winner for a long while just because it did so much better because the data was smaller. But something happened along the year and everybody is using now machine learning. I don't think there is any company that I know actually is not doing specifically deep neural network, even when sometimes you don't want to do those things, but just because everybody's doing that. So I put some numbers, and I know that some of you want to correct me for that. So this is not when stuff actually started, it's more when everybody believed that it's working. Okay, so it's, don't worry, you can tweak with the numbers a little bit. 2009 was the first time that I actually saw, and by the way, here I'm citing a guy from Toronto called Hinton, some of you might have heard him. He's the one who keep on doing those things, as everybody said, that neural networks are just second best. So 2009, something happened, okay? The neural network system started winning. They were doing better. So people start saying, hey, okay, I have a machine learning system that is doing better than a human. Let's follow that. 2012 was a remarkable change, and this goes well with medical imaging. This was what is known as the contents called the ImageNet. So the story is beautiful, by the way, if you never heard about it. So every year there is a contest trying to identify objects. What is a giraffe? What is an elephant? And so on. 2012, there was the... Did you talk about ImageNet yesterday? Did you talk about ImageNet? Do you remember?
Yeah.
Great. So 2012, what happened was the biggest contest out there. All the best groups in the world went to that contest trying to figure out what is the best way to identify objects. One group, by the way, by the leading, by the way, author, now I think it's in Facebook, actually. So they said, you know something? No model. I don't want to hear about models. Let's just take the data and plug it into a neural net, but let's make the neural net large enough. Okay, so they made a huge one, like 4 million unknowns. We'll talk about it in a second. And they ran it, and basically they won dramatically. They won like in 10% more than that, which is amazing. And everybody started actually using neural nets for that. A year after that, we've seen reinforcement learning. People won games. The Go game, I think last year, right? This is reinforcement learning. It's the same thing. It plays better. You know something? It made a mistake. Fine. But it's actually playing better. And 2014. So you know Siri, by the way? Yes, I'm sure everybody know that. You know when Apple bought them, by the way, the company? 2010. 4 years after that, I think this is the first time we actually see that it's doing dramatically better. Medical application, this is my favorite example actually. So around 2014, everybody were doing random forest. The reason why, because something came out of Microsoft Research like a few years before that, and it shows beautiful for motion detection. And then everybody was doing that for medical imaging. 2015, I think in every conference that I went to that related to medical imaging was about deep neural network. If it were not doing deep neural network, you were not there. So what the hell is happening? This is just a model with an infinity number of unknowns out there that you need to train. And if you know how to train it, okay, then you'll got yourself someone who's doing something better than you, at least with higher probability, okay, that's doing it better than you, whether you like it or not. This is actually how I want to end this lecture, okay, this is like the last minute. So first of all, some historical notes, okay, that you should not know about those learning machines, okay. Everybody should be doing something with learning needs to heard about it. First of all, it's been there for 70 years, the specific models that everybody is talking about. The second thing is that the modern one, the perceptron, which is like the basic unit that's been used, has been known since 58, okay? People talk about it for like 60 years. 69, what happened? Someone figured out, hey, there is a problem with the models, and this is why everybody like left that thing aside for like 10 years, which is amazing. Well, people continue doing that. 1975, the first algorithm was there, and now 2009 it was winning, just because there was more data, more computer power, nothing dramatically was altered actually in the algorithms, putting aside some tweaks that not going to be, actually, we're not going to go into that one. Advantages and disadvantages. This is the thing, the topics for the panel, I really think so. One, look, there is no way to build a model, okay? Meaning that some people call that a model, but if those are doing neural network, it's not exactly a model, okay? It's a system that learns, okay? It's very hard to explain what is happening. This is for the disadvantages. The results are better, that's the second one, and the system improves over time. The example that you gave, I think it's a beautiful one, because if you actually train it correctly, as the years move by, one day it's going to learn. Every even year it's like that, every non-even year it's like that, and it will do better, okay? It improves over time, like a human, roughly. The disadvantages, this is the big thing, okay? This is the big one, the big problem that you can basically crucify me for that. One, we need a lot of data. If you have small sets of data, now starts the problems, like the problem that you actually mentioned. Exactly the same thing. Now the problem appears. It's very hard to train. You need to know how to do that. This is part of, you know, the secret sauce of every company, to figure out how to solve those problems. It's very hard to explain why. In our case, for consumer credit, this is the FCRA. So I cannot give a reason because the computer said so or because A, B, and C. Okay, we need to actually explain what is happening. Doing that, not trivial, doable, okay? There is a way to go from neural network to actually explain what the hell is happening. And the third thing is actually it's harder to debug. You know, if there is a reason, something actually happens, someone gets a low score, someone can ask you, hey, why, what is happening? And the answer is the net, you know, this is how it predicted. But it's very hard to explain, and it's a biggie, okay? Those three things are big for medical, big issues for consumer credit, big thing for everything that there is a computer there. That's me, like I said. So we are actually giving loans. This is the first product out there. And we hope to give more and more financial services once we actually can, you know, when we actually can show that we are profiling dramatically better than what is done by billionizing. That's it.
Thank you. Judging by the looks on people's faces, it's going to be very interesting here later. Aaron, please.
Oh, maybe this one. I see. Thank you.
All right. First of all, thank you very much to the conference organizers for inviting me. My name is Aaron Rieke. I'm from an organization called Upturn in Washington, D.C. This is kind of a scary audience to present to. It's been a great couple days. I'm a mediocre lawyer. I'm a mediocre computer scientist. I'm bad at math. And so like everything that I can claim is a professional skill, there's someone in this room I can look at right now that's doing that better than me. So this is kind of scary. What I do in Washington, D.C. at Upturn is serve as a technical and policy advisor for national civil rights groups and national consumers. So I'm the guy that gets to be stuck between the law and the technology and try to explain both well enough to make social progress on some of these issues. I'm most interested when data and technology is used in a way that affects, that has socially consequential effects. I think pathways to social mobility was used as a phrase yesterday. That's the intersection I'm interested in. Credit scoring is a great example for this conference, and I think that it's no mistake that it came up again and again and again and again and again yesterday as we were thinking about explaining algorithms and what's important here, et cetera. I want to give some perspectives on where things are going here in the United States today. It's great to follow Dan, who's, it sounds like, trying to provide a great service for people that have no social security number, don't have data in the credit bureaus. I want to be very US-centric for a moment, and then I'll broaden it out again. Nick Diakopoulos gave me permission at dinner the night before last to pick on journalists, and that's where I want to start here. This is an NPR story that came out last month that says, will using artificial intelligence to make loans trade one kind of bias for another? There's stories like this almost every other week in the national press about new ways that credit scoring is going to change. Facebook is a really popular one, or it was for a while. These are a collection of headlines, how Facebook's gonna change your credit score. There's all kinds of creepy startup companies that are saying they're gonna use Facebook data to, you know, let your landlord evict you or let your employer fire you. I get really upset when I see these headlines for two reasons. Number one is I think that this would be garbage, and I don't wanna see any of this happen. Number two is, and Dan, you predicted this, I'm gonna be the guy that says FCRA, FCRA, FCRA. And so the pattern that I see, at least for United States consumers, is a startup company comes out, makes some grand claims about how they're gonna detect your punctuation or use your Facebook data to make credit decisions. And then I think they get big enough to hire a compliance counsel. And then they either kind of quietly disappear into the ether or start focusing on international markets. So I'm not saying that none of this is happening or none of it's important, but I want to push back in a pretty significant way against the idea that this is anywhere near the norm in the United States today for most people getting underwritten for loans. And I think that's important, and I also want to point out that as of, I think, April of last year, Facebook instituted this new policy that says, hey, outside folks, you just don't get to use our data for eligibility decisions, full stop. This is a global ban.
Not just Facebook, all of them.
Right. Well, I mean, no, it's just for Facebook data.
I'm saying all of them.
Yeah.
All the companies, roughly.
Yeah. Yeah, and this is an increase, this is a trend, right? And I think that there's a couple of reasons for this. I think one is Facebook makes money from people feeling like they should share on the platform and show them ads and make money, and if you creep them out, that's not good for business. The second is if Facebook just kind of stands by while everyone says this is happening, they're gonna start looking like a consumer reporting agency. And I'm sure their lawyers don't want that. And the other barrier here is that we have the Equal Credit Opportunity Act. If you start using like who my friends are and the things I like and where I live to judge me for credit, you're gonna have big disparate impact problems. And I would love to be a part of bringing that case when it comes. But I just wanna like level set here and talk about FICO and VantageScore for a second. Not because these are sexy new technologies, not because they cover the people whose social mobility I want to improve, but because this is where like 90% of lending decisions get made. These are important ingredients. 90% of lending decisions in the United States as of a year or two ago involved a FICO score alone. We're talking billions and billions and billions of scores being fed into decision-making processes that have important impacts. And so these are important companies. They are really old school in terms of the data they're using. Let's be clear about the data that's going into these credit scores. It's mostly, what are your loans? What are your credit cards? What are your balances? How well are you paying off those bills? That's most of it, right? In the interest of trying to include more people in credit scoring models, there's like a slight move to include things like whether you pay your cell phone bill, whether you pay your rent on time, whether you pay your utility. And then I think over here is where you know, Dan's starting to say, okay, like, talk to me about your employment, your income. Like, let's find some other factors that can help underwrite you. But the FICO score is like kind of over here in the corner on the data continuum. This brings me to explainability, right? This is an industry that's had a couple of decades to think about how to try to explain what's going on with credit scoring. And so this is VantageScore's explanation, and it's targeted at consumers. And it's like, okay, look, payment history up here is the biggest thing, right? Make sure you pay all your bills on time. It is good if you have had credit for a while and that you aren't using all of it. And then there's some factors down here that, that affect this more. And so I think I show this because this is industry state of the art consumer explanation of how. And I just want to at least suggest, not because I like credit scores, but to be responsive, I think Andrew yesterday said there's an infinite number of explanations, the toddler can keep asking why. I think this is a pretty good, like, adult toddler level explanation of what's going on in a FICO credit score. You know, it could be better, but it's all right. These are reason codes, so if you get, if you request your credit score under certain circumstances or you get rejected for a financial product where your credit score was used, you gotta give some reasons to the consumer about what happened, right? If you go to reasoncodes.org, I just discovered last night that VantageScore publishes all of their reason codes with like pages of explanation for each. And just, it's this like overwhelming library of samples of explaining what's going on with FICO scores. And I don't have my notes in front of me here. What they're gonna say is they're gonna give you three or four reason codes that describe which of these ding, essentially which of these ding you the most in descending order, right? You have too many collection agency accounts that are unpaid. Some of these are pretty clear. Some of them are a little vaguer. If you get non-monotonic ones playing against each other, occasionally you get some weird things. But I think that the question of whether or not this is good explanation for consumers in this context is open to some actual empirical research, because there are professional credit counselors that work with people every single day to understand how to improve their credit and understand the reason codes. This is another attempt to explain credit scoring. This is on Credit Karma. I don't know if any of you know the website Credit Karma. The deal with Credit Karma is you give us access to your consumer reports, we'll give you all kinds of interesting transparency information into that data, and then use it to advertise to you. But in exchange, you get this really cool little black box tester, right, where they show your current credit score, and you can simulate, like, what would happen if I opened a new credit card? What would happen if I closed an old credit card? Again, just another kind of mini black box test type sandbox for consumers to try to understand what's going on in the algorithm. I want to emphasize how basic the data that's actually doing the prediction here is. This is a VantageScore chart, and what this says is that 77% of consumers that are detected as likely to default are captured with just this first variable. The first payment history variable captures 77% of consumers going to be in the bottom part of the credit scoring range as likely to default. If you add the next 10 variables, that gives you 85%. And so what you have is really the predictive oomph of these credit history models are coming from like payment history. Just like the basic set of payment history is where the action is at. That's what's doing the prediction for the most part. The rest is just kind of getting up a little higher. FICO's been honest about the fact that they've tried to use neural nets and other fancy things to rebuild models using this existing data that they already have, and it doesn't make much difference in terms of the predictiveness. And I think the reason for that is it's a pretty small data set. It has a really clear, intelligible relationship to the thing that's trying to be predicted, which is, are you likely to go 90 days overdue on a payment in the next 2 years? And so I think this is interesting, but I also think it's another example of explanation. What happens when you throw in like some novel data or some big data on top of this data? So we already have good payment history prediction for you. This is another VantageScore result of an internal experiment where they threw in a bunch of Amazon shopping history data. So we already know your payment history, we already know all the other standard stuff. What happens when we throw in a bunch of Amazon data? It's piddly. It's really piddly. And it may be good when nothing else is available, but I want to emphasize how important payment history is to predicting default. So this may be a little aggressive and not entirely fair, but I want to suggest that there's kind of a range of predictive value for these sorts of data sets down this spectrum. Again, let's be clear about what we're trying to predict, which is this individual person likely to go 90 days overdue or have a similar sort of bankruptcy event for the next 2 years? It makes sense that if they're in the system, and you can see whether or not they're paying their bills or can pay their bills or seem to be overloaded, that's pretty close to what you're trying to predict. Yesterday, the example was given We're talking about gaming systems, right? And whether gaming systems was good or bad or should be allowable. And we thought that maybe a good model would be one that if you gamed it, you would actually be a better candidate for whatever that was. Credit scoring might be that, right? When you have a low credit score and FICO says to you, why don't you pay off some of your bills and get your debt to income ratio in order and pay your bills on time for a while. When they say those things and they give you those tips and reason codes and you do those things, you're probably becoming a better credit risk, right? And again, my goal here is not to praise the system. I'm gonna get harsher in a second, but I just wanna point out that I think that when you have data that's like has a close and intelligible relationship to the thing you're trying to predict, it gets a little easier and it gets a little more intelligible. Big problem, Dan covered this. In the United States, you've got a total of about 35 million people that don't have visibility to a FICO score, right? They don't have the requisite amount of data at a large credit bureau, if they have any data. Who are these 35 million people? They tend to be people who are low income, Black and Hispanic individuals over-indexing here, immigrants, you know, young people. There's lots of folks who are not the advantage in society that are just totally invisible to this, and that's one big issue. Another big issue is, what about bias? Okay, this is a relatively simple system. Payment history is the overriding predictive factor. What can we, like, is there racial bias in the system? That was a question that Congress asked the Federal Reserve Board in 2007. And this is a great study. I'm surprised at how many people haven't seen the study. I always like tease it to people here, have you seen this Federal Reserve Board study? So the Federal Reserve Board was asked to investigate the presence of racial bias in credit factors used for credit history score. And what it did is, and I made some notes here so I get the numbers right, it got about 300,000 anonymized credit files from the big credit bureaus, 2 years apart with credit scores. They added in demographic data, ethnicity, gender, immigration status, stuff like that, into the credit files from the Social Security Administration. So now they have a rich data set. They have the demographic data they care about. They can do what you were saying, finally. and their way of investigating this was to use that data set, which was a limited universe of data, and build their own models. So they built a model to estimate what they thought the industry standard FICO score and Vantage score models were doing. And then they rebuilt those models in race-neutral environments and age-neutral environments. And what they were looking for is when we build a model just for white people, or just for Black individuals, or just for any other class of people, do the weights change? And if the weights in the model change when we build them in race-neutral environments or age-neutral environments, that's a bad sign. What that says is that the existing variables that are in there are somehow the value of that variable is tied to something that shouldn't be considered. What they found in this study, and I'm not gonna say that this is conclusive evidence in one way or the other, because I'm not qualified to say that, is they said the weights aren't changing when we build in race-neutral environments. That's a good sign that the predictive value of these variables isn't coming because they are a proxy for race. They did find that age of credit history, which is an important factor, was a strong proxy for age. And they said, well, that kind of sucks because you shouldn't be discriminating based on age. On the other hand, there's so much predictive value in the age of your credit history that we're just gonna kind of like be okay with that, right? And when you look in Regulation B, you see some heightened requirements on credit scoring systems that consider age. So this is a really interesting study. I commend it to anyone who's interested in credit scoring. It covers more than just this kind of technical audit. But I think it's a fascinating example of trying to understand an important algorithmic system without access to FICO or Vantage score. But this was made possible because we know the limited universe of data that goes into these decisions. I'm gonna wrap up. I promise not to go into my buffer time. Let me close with a few points. The first is, when you see US journalists talk about big data in credit models, just be skeptical about that. And I, you know, it might be used for some fraud prevention sorts of stuff. It might be used for authentication sorts of stuff. If you're manually considering someone's professional history, LinkedIn might be a useful way to verify that. But I think it's important to be clear about the role this is playing in the system. It's a mess abroad, right? And I don't want to like be so US-centric that I'm saying don't worry about this at all, right? In the global South especially, where there's not good credit reporting infrastructure, these are becoming experimentation grounds on use of all kinds of new data. And the argument is, well, it's better than nothing, let's try and see what happens. Baidu in China is doing crazy stuff with web browsing searches and history. And so, but I just think that, you know, when journalists talk about like SAT scores and grammar being used in the United States unripe for credit, email the journalists and ask them for a source. And most will write back sheepishly and say, oh, it looks like I was looking at a company, you know, in China or something like that. So because of that, credit scoring in the US is still largely driven by credit history data. There's some pros to this, I think, right? The first is that there's an understandable relationship to creditworthiness. And this, interestingly, is not my language. The OCC, which is a federal banking regulator, offers a safe harbor in the business necessity defense context, in part if there's an understandable relationship to creditworthiness. And I think that's like an interesting, like hidden away little nugget of a federal regulator saying, like, if this is understandable, we're going to give you more credit. And by understandable, I just mean, I think there's a close nexus between do you pay your bills and are you going to be able to sustain additional credit. I think there's some decent explanations. I really do. I think that all the examples I showed you are pretty good explanations, either for end consumers or for someone who's more technical, like this audience, wanting to understand where the predictive power of the model is coming from. I don't want to hold it up as the gold standard. I mean, sorry, Mark, looking at you. But I do think that what I want some help thinking about is I feel like the onus is on me as an advocate in Washington, D.C., working with regulators, to ask for more. What would more look like? What would better look like? And I want to be honest in this audience and say, it's not immediately clear to me in terms of understanding what's going on at the very least. And it's nice that predictiveness doesn't appear to derive directly from protected class status. Big cons, a lot of people get left out of this. Tens of millions of people get left out of this in the United States. There are efforts to help fix that. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau right now has an open comment period on what sorts of new data would be helpful. What types of new modeling would be helpful? What types of new data sources would be helpful? If any of you have an interest in this, please give the CFPB your best thoughts. And I don't want to leave this out or undersell it at the end of this presentation. There are staggering disparities in how FICO and Vantage scores are distributed across different protected classes in this country. And it's really, really sad. Like, it's part of what comes with the territory of, okay, look, do you have money? Are you financially stable? Can you pay your bills? If that's essentially your prediction criteria, and you hold that up to society, of course there are staggering disparities. And so I don't want to end this presentation by saying, look how I can explain this all, this is great. Because I don't think it is. And so I just want to leave two questions. More data can help score more people, but I want to think carefully about these trade-offs. One trade-off is, unfortunately in the United States, credit scores can be used for more than their intended predictive purpose, right? Oftentimes you have a credit score that will be used when you're applying for a job, or that will be included in an insurance underwriting, or will be used to like give you housing, right? And I think that when credit scores are used in purposes where they haven't been validated to be used, that's hugely problematic. And so when I talk to advocates for low-income individuals about expanding the data set for scoring, they have these very practical concerns. Okay, if you put Susan's utility bill repayment behavior in her credit file, when she applies for a job, someone's going to see that. Is it better to have a low credit score or no credit score? The fact that that's even a question to which the answer isn't clear is really distressing. And I think part of the drag on this issue is the fact that in the United States, you can use credit scores for things that they weren't intended to be used for. And advocates know that. And so they get skeptical about even marginal ways to include more people in credit underwriting. And that sucks. And can we just find a better way, right? Like, FICO is interesting, but it's really, really blunt. And it's really, really slow. And it just doesn't capture all these people, and it doesn't capture people in a nimble way, right? Like, people can have rapid financial ups and downs, and like, I don't want, like, it's too bad that FICO is kind of ensconced as the way things work in the United States. There are some positive properties, but like, can we just find a better way, right? Can we find a system that, like, gosh, wouldn't it be nice if this actually helped to promote equity a little bit instead of just accurately, like, soberly reflect disparities in society? And so that's where I want to end. And hopefully we can do more discussion later.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I just wanted to begin the presentation by thanking and congratulating Helen, Kathy, NYU on 5 years of algorithmic accountability, at least, right? Because I think 5 years ago we had this huge conference here on algorithmic accountability. I thought it was a real watershed, and this has sparked, I think, a global debate, global interest in these topics. We did a big conference at Yale last year. The LSE is working on it. It's international, so that's something that really should be remarked and celebrated. I'll also say that, you know, in terms of my presentation today, I want to mark one continuity and four discontinuities. The one continuity will be Aaron's point about staggering disparities. I'm going to try to dive right in on that. So I think my presentation flows naturally from his today. In terms of discontinuity, I think in terms of the medical presentation today, which I thought were incredibly insightful, and I use some of Karwan's work in my own health IT law class on black box medicine, there's a big difference, say, in the context of medicine and finance, because by and large, in medicine, we're kind of all on the same team, I think. You know, the doctor really wants to see you get well. In finance, if there's any lesson of chapter 4 of my book, The Black Box Society, or of countless investigations post global financial crisis, it is that we're not necessarily all on the same team. Which will finally lead me to a final discontinuity, which is to say nothing that I'm saying here is necessarily a jibe at any particular firm. Like dance, you know, it's just some observations about the nature of credit and surveillance in the US. So I'm going to start with rival views from esteemed economists on using, say, proprietary secret algorithms in credit scoring. And Larry Summers, I think, has made a pretty penny advising firms that go with a model in terms of proprietary secret algorithms. And he tells a pretty Whiggish story of progress, of gradual inclusion of more and more people through the use of markets and technology. I would contrast that with the president of the National Economics Association, Derek Hamilton, who has argued that we should federalize credit scores, and I think that's a version of nationalization, because he says that something that is so powerful should not be left to the private sector, should be transparent, and should have the accountability that comes with being a government official. Okay. And now that might seem like a pretty tough stance, right? But if we think about the history of credit rating organizations, for example, nationally recognized statistical rating organizations, the NSRSOs, that are part of, say, credit rating in the company context, et cetera, it's pretty clear that a lot of times what's going on in these contexts is that governmental judgment is essentially being outsourced to a private entity. And so what I want to do is I want to compare these two views. And a big theme of my talk is that perhaps these perspectives are irreconcilable, and the academics need to be able to embrace that irreconcilability. Now, why might they be irreconcilable? I think they are because if we look at the philosophy of social science, a lot of philosophy of social science observes that when we think about explanations of historical events or larger scale explanations of, say, what's going on in a socio-technical system, there's a breakdown between, say, functionalism and conflict theory. You know, there's a great history of functionalism. You know, we think of Durkheim, we think of other forms of social theory that model, say, lots of economics, modeling phenomena in terms of an organism, that what we're really looking at is equilibrium, that we want to see as positive sum cooperation to expand resources. I promise I'm going to come back to credit scores. I promise. Just trying to sneak in a little bit of philosophy of social science. But if we look at conflict theory, you know, conflict theory says, no, wait a second. You know, in many situations in life, we're in zero-sum conflicts. We've got class conflict, racial conflict, gender conflicts, et cetera. Who's going to take care of the kids tonight? Who's going to do the various things? You know, we've got conflicts all over the place. And a lot of these conflicts boil down to struggles for positional advantage, where there are winners and losers. Okay, and so that's, I think, really illuminating. And I want to add on to this model of conflict theory versus functionalism, methodological holism versus individualism, and talk about four approaches to credit scoring, and particularly to the expansion of data and surveillance to potentially open up credit to more people. I'll start with a methodologically individualistic standard microecon approach that is functionalist, which is something I tend to call the axis of Toronto and Chicago. Okay. So there are scholars at Chicago, like Strahilovitz, who have, for a decade, talked about the importance of bringing more information to bear on determinations so that people aren't judged on the basis of ascriptive characteristics. To translate that a bit, rather than having someone come up to an office who is, say, African American, and the boss saying, well, all I know is what's on your resume, and I am, and the boss is not gonna say I'm biased, but they might be biased, I'm not gonna hire you, okay? That might happen, and what Strahilovitz says is, well, let the person who, say, is African American or a discriminated against group bring more and more data to that interaction so they can say, you might have a stereotype, but I'm not like your stereotype, okay? That, I think, is brought to its ultimate conclusion in Ben Aleri's work toward the legal singularity, where the argument is literally that if we knew had perfect information about everything all the time, about everybody, we could personalize all legal rules to optimize happiness in society. Okay? And that is also put forward in an article called The Death of Rules and Standards by Casey and Niblett, again from respectively Chicago and Toronto. Okay? Very powerful strand of legal thought there. Now, there's also a more methodologically holist approach that I tend to distinguish as either Whiggish social science or PR, public relations, which is to say, and I'm not saying the Whiggish social scientists are PR people, I'm just saying that that happens where people say, you know, over time, what's going on here is the good people are getting more credit and we're finding out who's good, and the bad people are getting less. And that's a good thing. Evolutionarily, it makes sense, right? On the other hand, though, we have very strong voices who are, I think, rooted in the tradition of conflict theory in social science. People like Israhi and Stuckey in their book, Virtual Competition. Stuckey and Grunis in some of their modeling of big data and competition policy, who give model after model of exploitation, not assistance, not helpfulness, exploitation by large entities that have lots of data about people versus consumers that have very little data about what's going on in the outside. And that's the whole thing of my black box book, right? The whole thing of my black box society book is that to the extent that these large companies are saying, we want to know more and more and more and more about you, we need to turn that around and say, well, yes, okay, and we need to know more and more and more about you, okay? That's the bargain I propose in the book. Of course, it's ran into massive resistance, primarily in America. It's more better reception abroad in China, Europe, Taiwan, Canada, et cetera. But that's the bargain I propose. Finally, I'm finding more and more social science on this methodologically holist conflict theory approach that, you know, broadly approves of what I'm saying, okay, or tries to go in that direction. And I think particularly when we think about a lot of privacy and surveillance credit from a critical race theory perspective, or from a perspective, say, in Lux and Guventa on levels of power, those are also stories that you can tell that I think are very important in these contexts. And I'm gonna go through each of these different areas, trying to get each of its due, because I want to be fair. I mean, I realize it's the academy. I'm not like part an advocate. I really want to be trying to give each one its due. The standard microeconomic approach would say something like a two-sided market needs reputation mechanisms to match borrowers and lenders, okay? And the idea there is that the more information a scoring system has, the better it's going to get, right? I think this was sort of Dan's response to Rich, perhaps. It's certainly the response I've gotten from my students. And the idea here is that, you know, you can overcome bias, and I want to give them some credit for a particular point where Strahilovitz was, I think, ahead of the game. There was an effort by a lot of activists to say, we don't want to have employers ask about whether someone was a felon or not. So over 50 municipalities, other states said, you know, at least at the first stage of the application process, we ban this box where you would be asked about being a felon. Okay. What the folks who did standard microeconomics sort of responded was, well, then bosses are just gonna fall back on their old prejudices. They're not gonna have this extra information that's going to allow people to say, I'm not a felon. And there has been some recently published material that says that does happen. That apparently in some of the places where they ban the box, there's more discrimination, or at least it has some disparate impact. So that's a tough finding for privacy advocates, right? And certainly lots more research has to be done. but it's something we've got to put on the agenda. Now, the week of social science I want to talk about, though, I think we could go too quickly toward that, and I think if Aaron can use Angry Cat, I'm going to use the Why Though meme. Which is, on the one side, you could have a narrative of progress that would say what's going on here is as we get more and more information about everybody, nobody can hide, okay? And so if anyone's heard of the Chinese social credit scoring system, which tried to integrate lots of fringe data, the proposal is, it hasn't been implemented, but the proposal is to integrate lots of data about people. The rationale for that system, I think apparently from the beginning of the social credit scoring document was, we want to create data-driven metrics about people so that the trustworthy can travel around the globe and the untrustworthy cannot take a single step. It's the literal governmental rationale to build on this Baidu example. So, but you can see that certainly making sense from a sort of sociobiological perspective, right? Like, we retaliate against the shirkers. Do something to these people, punish them, teach them that, they might be trapped in a spiral of not getting credit if they do anything wrong. Oof, nice normalization potential there. I'd also say, though, that the folks on the profit side, the more PR side, business side, say, it's nothing personal going on here, it's just business. There's no personal animus or discrimination, etc. So, I match that up with the insouciant meme speak, which has become the public philosophy of a great portion of our society now. They say, why though? You want to know why? Well, why do you want to know why? That has been my experience in many of these contexts. Well, I want us to contemplate on the data coding level, and we talked a bit in the beginning session today about inter-observer variation, coding bias, problems of coding, etc. Do we code a scenario like this as a good thing? Let's say that Joe takes out a 35% APR loan from a lender. And by the way, I use that number for a reason, because I think Google banned payday loans, but I think the definition is under 36%.
Under 36,
yeah. So here's that example. Let's say that desperate to repay it, he doesn't buy food for his kids, they go hungry some days, but he gets it done, and the lender's paid back in full and makes a profit, okay? Well, I guess from one perspective, you might say, what a triumph of machine learning and precision analytics that we found this underserved branch of the market that's willing to let the kids go a little hungry so they pay off the loan, right? One way of explaining it. You could also say that, hey, it's just about business, right? It's just about, the borrower isn't our client, the other folks are our clients. It's other people that we really care about. But what I hope we can think more deeply about and reflect upon is, can we try to get some of that other side of the story into our systems? But we have to be careful as we do, because we can run into the problem of accuratism, right? Getting more and more and more data. Maybe the answer some folks might be, well, we would also add, say, family distress to our analytics to really measure it right. I don't know. And of course, we see some examples from certain labs saying, we want to know your number of friends on Facebook, et cetera, we want to know likes frequency. I wanted to add the other example, as something that, is a recent development in, say, accuratism, which is some folks are looking into face recognition. And I know there's a typo on the slide, but what I love about it is they sort of are trying to use certain things in terms of, we're doing facial analytics to see if people are lying about how old they are or about how much they weigh. And I love this example at the very bottom. Two people of the same chronological age rarely experience the same rate of biological aging. You know this intuitively just by attending your high school reunion, right? That's why I put on a little anti-aging cream this morning. Yeah, watch out for this stuff. And, this sort of thing about seeing who's misrepresenting himself, more and more data, just give us more and more data. I do think we have to be careful about this, because it gets a little creepy. It goes beyond creepy, though, which is to say, to come to our critical economics of exploitation, we're now seeing more and more people who are saying, like Israhi and Stuckey, they come out with, or at least Israhi comes out with the idea that often online entities know so much more about us than we know about them, it's like we're operating in a Truman Show. There's such a data asymmetry. And if you combine that with the work that Tristan Harris and others are doing about, the ways in which app users, others are using certain cues, certain behavior modeling, certain experimentation. We heard about the positive side of experimentation from the first presentation today. I want to talk a little bit about the negative side. That this can be used in ways that are against our interests or those interests of those around us. So I'd also say that, when we go think about social science beyond economics, the work of people like Kiara Bridges, anthropologists, sociologists, etc. Her Poverty of Privacy Rights is coming out in June. I highly recommend it. I interviewed her about it for a podcast called The Week in Health Law last week. This sort of social science really gives a sense of what it's like on the ground to be somebody that's interrogated all the time, right? And she looks at welfare recipients who were being interrogated by the government all the time. Oh, do you have a new boyfriend? What's your boyfriend's job? How long do you think you'd be with a boyfriend? Does that boyfriend spend a lot of time with your kids or not? You know, these sorts of interrogations, she finds, are very corrosive for a lot of the people who experience them. And I'm reminded of a review of my book that was done by a feminist scholar, Nicole DeLandre, who she said at the very end, you know, looking at Frank's book, he's talking all about these people upset by surveillance. Well, welcome to the world of women, okay? Welcome to the world where we, as feminist scholars, have been talking for decades about the ways in which we are scrutinized and evaluated and all this data is gathered about us in unfair ways. And that's something that, you know, now everyone's being subject to, but now finally that everyone's being subject to, now you're hearing complaints about it, right? And so this is where I think we really need to look back at the critical race theory, look at some of the people who are talking in these discourses, because they've been covering the unexpected and untoward and troubling consequences of excess surveillance for decades. Okay. And finally, you know, the problem of normalization is key too. I see I'm running out of time, so I'll skip through these, but I think Bernard Harcourt and Bogart both develop ways in which of saying that these sorts of systems can normalize behavior and make people feel they have to behave in narrower and narrower ranges, etc. And that's yet another problem out of the systems. So to conclude, the two last slides I'll say is that, you know, I embrace contestation here. I don't think you can reconcile the perspectives of Summers and Derek Hamilton. I think it's very hard to reconcile the functionalist and conflict approaches. I talk about narratives and counter-narratives in my recent work on platform capitalism. I compare the two in this chart, all available online. And I think that, you know, as we do that, we have to realize that functionalism is really normatively appealing in a well-ordered society. We are not there. And as long as we're not there, we have to make sure that when we seek to explain, to understand, to write about, to talk about the larger social context of these systems, that we have a healthy dose of the conflict theories on both the methodologically individualist and holist levels. Thank you.
Okay. And with that note, we're going to start taking questions. Yes.
So I'm Mark McCarthy with Georgetown and SIIA. Great presentations. My friend here has especially raised the larger normative issues that you have to keep in mind when you think about something as particular as credit scores. But I want to focus on the statistical disparities that Aaron talked about, which is a problem no matter how you think about the conflict in society and these larger questions. I think we genuinely think there should be something done to change that situation. And I want to focus on the finding that Aaron mentioned, which is that the scores seem to be okay from the point of view of being racially neutral. And yet because the disparities that they find in the data reflect underlying group differences, you get this different distribution of credit scores. And my question is, should the designers and the users of credit scores take extra steps to go beyond the kind of accuracy that they're aiming for, to do something to be more in the direction of statistical parity? And if they do that, to what extent would they wind up getting themselves in trouble from the point of view of disparate treatment under discrimination law theory?
Aaron, you want to go first?
Yeah. So first of all, let me recommend anyone that wants to explore that view. I recommend a paper by the National Consumer Law Center called Past and Perfect. And they take a hard look at the disparities in credit scoring and where they end in their paper. The paper ends with a graphic that on one side has equality and one side has equity. And the position that they take is part of making these scores more just may be finding ways to lift people up who, because of decades of oppression, are in a crappy place today. I have not done the legal legwork to think about what the legal consequences of doing that would be. but I think it's a really vital and important question, right? And I just want to I want to echo that Frank's presentation and contrasting these different philosophical views and tensions of where we're at is so incredibly alive and vibrant when I work with consumer groups and civil rights groups about credit scoring. There's this very hard tension between the recognition on one hand that invisibility is a really bad place to be if you want to rely on mainstream financial products. On the other hand, they recognize better than anyone else that there's problems with just giving the corporations more data. I think that that's where the conversation has to head at some point to try to reconcile that. Either we're going to do credit scoring just isn't the way to go, and we want to go back to a more personalized model. I think there's all kinds of bias traps over there. Or there's another paper I'd recommend to people that people look at called it's out of Google called Equal Opportunity and Machine Learning. It's a very broadly titled paper, but it looks very deeply at what would it take to use machine learning to define cutoff rates outside of the credit scoring black box. So you have a score like FICO, and you might want to balance in different ways the distribution of how credit is extended to different protected classes, and what could those trade-offs look like. And I would commend that as an example of another paper that plays with those ideas.
Fred, would you like to add?
I think I have more questions. I have something that might be related, but I just want to hear some more questions first.
Yeah. Dan?
Yeah, actually one thing. So actually it's a beautiful question. So the thing is that It also goes back, I think, to what Aaron said before that, you know, about like companies who figure out that they need to follow the FCRA, they should not discriminate and so on. They ended up figuring out that the US is not the best place to be in. So it conceptually for me, it goes all the way, meaning that I would love to give another company as an example, okay? So we follow FCRA rules, right? But the people who actually come to us are those who are invisible. So what am I saying? So you see, so our system sees only those that are invisible, right, in the end of the day. But making sure that you are not, for example, you know, giving too much weight to different things, so there are ways to fix those things, okay? So personally, I think it should be there, okay? And following the rules is exactly what we're doing. So the answer is yes. It a little bit actually goes back to something that I told us. I used the rich example for that. It goes back to the biased, so you don't need to make sure that you are unbiased. And there are ways to fix that. If you have a system that's going to see 1,000 people in one state, right, and only 100 that have a different, let's say, race. Okay, let's go with sex. 1,000 males, 100 females. If you actually train the system, you cannot take that if you want to be gender invariant. Okay, so what I'm saying is there are solutions, there are ways to do that. And somehow FCRA actually here, even though it's strict, it actually takes care of many of those things if you follow these rules. So I think it's done in some sense if you play by the rules. I don't know if it answered that, but this is roughly how I see that.
Okay. Andrew.
Hi. Andrew Selfs, Yale Information Society Project. So if the issue, this can be to any of you on the panel, if the issue is somewhat, if the disparity issue is largely that we have a huge wealth disparity in the country, and that disparity is not uniform among protected classes, I would wonder if the very concept of creditworthiness is really to blame, because if the goal is really to predict who will pay back the loan, like I can't see how you can do it other than by looking at wealth. Are there things but creditworthiness is not necessarily the obvious way to determine who gets a loan or who has access to, I don't know, money in general that they might not have. I'm wondering if there's some other like radical idea that any of you guys have thought about that might replace even the concept of trying to predict who is better to pay back a loan, like a minimum credit line or something, something like that.
Yeah. Fred.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I really appreciate that question, Andrew, and I want to connect, it gives me a chance to speak about the context. I think is really critical here, because to some extent we may be expecting the private market to do something not only that it can't do, but that it's designed to work against. And so, for example, I would give the example of student lending. Right, with respect to a lot of student lending, you have a system now where we moved to direct loans in 2010 that moved a lot of the lending out of the
private market into like direct lending by the government. The positive side of that is that if you're going to, whether you're going to say a very wealthy school or one with lots of wealthy students, or you're going to a poorer school that doesn't have many students, you know, that has lots of poorer students, they're all starting out at the same rate. Now, of course, thanks to innovations, I think like SoFi and some of these other companies, they are trying to sort of cherry pick, right? They're trying to say, oh, let's give the folks from Harvard and NYU, et cetera, like a 2% rate or a 1% rate. And that way, and one of the problems as that happens is that the overall financial sustainability of the direct loan program is undermined, right? Because if you allow the private sector to systematically cherry pick the best risks from a public loan system, then you're going to create, as CBO continually insists in its effort to revolt against the 1990 Federal Credit Reform Act and impose something called fair value accounting, you get the CBO undermining fiscal projections for the returns from this program, and then you end up that, in turn, creates pressure to put either higher interest rates or put other sorts of limitations on it. By the way, some of the limitations could be good, right? I mean, some of the colleges out there are clearly predatory. That's how I believe we should be limiting it. We should be looking very carefully. Obama administration took a step in that direction with the gainful employment rule, right? But as it stands, that's yet another really interesting, difficult distributional conflict. Very few people are looking at this distributional conflict at all. And when I try to bring it up with activists and advocates, I'm actually going to a meeting in Chicago next week on exactly this issue. You know, I've had a bit of difficulty because it's hard to figure that out exactly. But I think that over time, what we're going to realize is that, and this goes back to Derek Hamilton's talk from my first slide, that the problems are way bigger than what the private market can solve. Oftentimes, the private market profits from exacerbating the problem. And to the extent even that the private market seems to be offering better deals to people that are in the public system, they may well be undermining the viability of the public system and even worsening things there as well.
Do you want to add something?
So how can I start? So here's the thing. There are many ways to look at a person's ability for credit, within the rules that do not just go to the question, does he have money, yes or no, for example. Let me give you an example of two people, okay? Both of them now have in a bank $1,000, okay? And both of them can pay for a loan, both of them have salaries. One have a stable salary coming in every month, $1,000. He has a median, $1,000, mean, $1,000. The other person has some random number going between 100 and that could be a 2,000 or 1,900, whatever. The mean will be the same. You can go for the median will be the same. Who is better? Okay, on which one do you actually want to go with for that? What I'm saying is that there are a lot of things about the person who can actually predict like what is ability to pay. Not just does he have money, yes or no. The thing is what mentioned here about the cherry picking, unfortunately, I agree. I agree for that for every cred, every ranking system there is. This is unrelated to how you're going to do that. If it's going to be FICO, yes or no. This is what is happening in the US for the last, right? From the moment FICO is there in some sense. So every ranking system that will be there will do cherry picking, no matter how you call it. The fact that I couldn't get a loan because I was not considered prime or near prime, I could get a loan in a horrible rate, right? I was not picked in the cherry picking this time. So any ranking system will have this problem. And the question, is it solvable, yes or no? Do you want to remove the ranking system altogether? It will come pop up with dramatically other problems. So people need credit, okay? So you're living in a society that lives on credit. So if you don't want to rank them and you don't want to give everyone credit, what will happen in the end of the day, the credit cost is going to be so high that in some sense nobody might be able to get it.
Well, I think that, if you're talking about a solely private market situation, but if we're looking at the situation of the US where there's such a big mix of public and private financing, not necessarily.
Yeah. At the risk of blocking questions, I just want to add one response to what Andrew said. I think that's a great question, and I think I struggled not to close myself off to that kind of imagination as I am involved with the details in DC. I want to point out that one part of this trend is the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, right, who's in charge of protecting consumers, has focused on it, has like this laser focus on ability to repay as the prime underwriting question, right? That's embedded in the payday lending rules that I hope they get out the door, but I'm not holding my breath for. You know, they recently had a request for information about how to get banks to open up balance data and cash flow data, that consumers should be able to take that data to different underwriting processes with the idea that how much money is coming into your bank account and how much you have is good, timely data about your ability to repay, right? And so I just want to point out that there's kind of a wind here from the federal consumer protection side where that's the right way to do this, because where people suffer is when they get into loans they can't repay.
And can I just say also about that, the narrowness of metrics and the importance of holism and connecting things. It's so key here, because the thing that I just mentioned, that gainful employment rule, on one level I like it, but I'm also writing an article now with the general counsel for the debt collective, which represents a lot of people that were defrauded by for-profit colleges. And what we comment on in looking at that rule is when you so narrowly focus there on income after graduation, what the government is essentially saying to a lot of colleges and universities is, get rid of your research functions, get rid of your student services functions, be in a dump, be as, you know, get rid of anything that could detract from your ability to ensure a high-paying job for the student right afterward, right? Or the higher-paying job. So these metrics can be extremely powerful. It's a theme of Kathy O'Neill's book, Weapons of Mass Destruction, you know, one of the most important books in this field. And I think that's a really critical perspective.
Helen.
Frank, this kind of jumps from something you said, but I'm happy to open this question to everybody. It's this point about if they're going to learn, these folks are going to learn more and more about us, we deserve to know more and more about them, and as you said, the theme of your book. So I want to know whether you are ready to go all the way, like David Brin, and say, well, it's okay. I don't care how far we go along this trajectory, as long as that conditional continues to hold, or do you think there's some ideal kind of stopping point where we say, that's enough? And the reason I ask in the context of this panel and like the topic of the panel, consumer credit and explainability in context, is because, and I'm raising a question many people have raised, because if it turns, and this question about should we extend the features that we allow to be included in credit evaluation, and you know, Dan and probably hints to some of the work that you're doing too. Let's say we just open the door and we say, look, credit, consumer credit people, you can look at everything, because it's possible that you're going to detect some pattern that by just limiting us to financial information, I mean, look at everything, look at health data, look at education, as you say, like family distress.
Social,
you know, just throw it all in, because maybe we're going to get something more accurate or more correct. Is there like a technical problem? Is there an ethical problem? And we can't explain why we get the results. They're just accurate.
I think to go to your first point about, you know, do I really want to see the David Brin transparent society? No, absolutely not. I mean, all that I'm sort of using it as is, it just so deeply troubles me that, you know, you have people like, you know, Richard Posner modeling privacy as an obstacle to market exchange, to efficiency, et cetera, but then when it comes to corporate trade secrecy, oh, well, that's a property right, that's awesome. Right, there cannot be that level of discontinuity, or else, you know, society just crumbles, I think, if we have that. But I will say that, you know, with respect to what's also we have to be really aware of on the horizon of legal discourse, is that there are scholars from this legal singularity crowd from Toronto who really believe that not merely credit scoring, but all law should be adjusted on the basis of a big data profile of you. So it would say, wow, you know, Frank doesn't drive that often, so the speed limit for him is going to be 25 miles an hour, you know? And this sort of ability in the smart city was actually also really interestingly modeled by Larry Solomon in an article in the Washington Law Review on a potential Shanghai administrative artificial intelligence traffic agency that would adjust everything, you know, according to this sort of big data. That is a model for some folks, you know, but I think what is the problematic about it is that if they want, to the extent that these types of big data, predictive analytics, AI models want to govern our lives, I go back to Derek Hamilton's quote. They have to be just like the government. They have to be as accountable and as transparent. They have to have things like the Administrative Procedure Act applied to them, and what my colleague Daniel Citron called for in 2008, which is technological due process. If we don't have all that, then we have to be really wary about further creep of some of these systems in the management of human beings.
I don't have a good answer to your question, but I just want to offer that there are lots of startup companies going to regulators in DC and saying, okay, we understand we can't use our opaque, unintelligible big data models for credit scoring today, but what if they're invisible anyway, right? What if the answer is going to be no because they don't have a FICO score? Can we be the second shot, right? Can we have a safe harbor for the second shot at this, right? Which when I ask people about what they think about the answer to that question, I get really divergent responses. Like it's a troubling, uncomfortable question because you're putting the pragmatism of maybe you can get a yes against, you know, this is going to be a horribly biased, problematic way of doing predictions, right? Given when society has all of the embedded problems it does today, when you start adding new stuff to a credit model, you're going to proxy directly to factors that we don't want used as basis for judgment. It's just going to happen. And so I don't know.
Can I just say, just as someone who studied like financial regulatory arbitrage, I know exactly what will happen if you get the second shot safe harbor. Suddenly everybody's going to look invisible. I mean, this is the history of financial regulation, is it is so easy to characterize a credit default swap as not being insurance, so it's don't worry. You know, all these sorts of things, I can give you endless examples in chapter 4 of my book. So you have to be incredibly vigilant when you offer these types of safe harbors, because the finance lawyers are so smart.
I'm not kidding.
Okay. Do you want to add something?
There are problems, right, but there is no solution now. Okay, I think it's easy to say, hey, there are problems, it might be biased, maybe if you don't have enough data, it will be biased. Yes, there are issues, I do get it. The thing is that there is no other solution now, and there is no replacement for ranking system now. And if there will be, I would love to hear about it.
With this very optimistic note, I want to thank our panelists and... Thank you.